30 seconds. Ten, nine, eight, seven, six.
LoveLine is meant for an adult audience. LoveLine may contain sexually oriented content. Listener discretion is advised. Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
LoveLine, coast to coast.
Hey, everybody, it's LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That's Dr. Drew. 1-800-LOVE-191. Dr. Drew, board certified physician, addiction medicine specialist. Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, buddy boy.
What you got? Oh, Drew's got some animal pictures.
Yeah, I do, as a matter of fact, given that you were just giving me endless grief as we ended the show last
All
night.
All I said was, I never heard of that tripod.
No, I believe the words were, it doesn't exist, you made it up, how dare you.
Taper.
What is a taper?
What
Here
is a
go.
Taper?
There
Let
you
me
go.
See that thing. Well, T-A-P-I-R.
Did I describe it properly or not?
Yeah, kind of. Yeah, it was a pig with a snout, sort of an elephant trunk. Yeah,
and
I have seen this animal.
And when they eat, they sound like you.
I think they call them something else, though. What I mean, I think people mistake them for something else.
People?
Are they in some family? Hey, listen, what's his nose over here? The genius, Liam Lynch, last night. I didn't know what you're talking about either.
Yeah, except I showed him the pictures afterward. I don't remember if he'd seen them.
True, last night, like a schoolgirl. He was like, right. Adam, where are you going? I'm like, I'm going home. Oh, wait, I'm on the internet. I got to find the taper. I'm like, show me tomorrow. I don't know what I said. I just left.
You didn't say anything.
Oh. Well, maybe just, you just know left. I was leaving. Yeah. Well, Drew, you know how it is. If I don't get out of here by 12:01 and a half, I turn into a pumpkin.
Yeah.
All right, so
All right,
this
so
is the
go.
Taper. It's, yeah. But I'll tell you, you know the thing that's, no, I never knew what you're talking about, but I'll tell you, when the caller or when our screener said T-A-P-E-R,
yeah.
It was like, no, that doesn't exist.
Yeah.
And then that's from Dr. Doolittle. And then when you see T-A-P-I-R, you go, that could be something. What is that? One letter?
Yeah.
Makes a difference, doesn't it?
Yeah.
It's like, oh, that's something I never heard of. E-R doesn't exist. I-R, I gotta learn more about this exotic animal. Well, I brought in a piece of paper too, Drew.
Oh, yeah. Ooh,
yeah.
With writing on it.
Yeah, writing on
Whoa.
It.
Whoa.
Yeah, those are.
Mr. Carolla, I'm impressed.
Words strung together. Huh. We have no guests tonight. I was at the down at the Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach today, taking some practice runs.
Another sleep deprived.
Oh, it's great. Go to
run
bed.
Around the track.
Go to bed at 2, get up at 6:30. It's huge. Buzz Aldrin went right into the wall, by the way.
Oh, no.
Yeah, destroyed his car. It was great. I get this, I guess I get it once a year. I think we did this last year, but we have some new affiliates, and some of you may not have heard it or not. But and it's, I don't know why I do it. I'm not really trying to prove too big a point, but I just find it interesting. It's my Social Security statement. And a lot of people in this business don't want to divulge what they get paid for things or what they make for things. And especially in radio.
Yeah.
Because believe me, if you found out how much these sea-sucking morning shows and afternoon guys were getting paid, you would hate their guts. That's the way it works. When people find out what radio guys make, they get angry. And
Although I recall we were at dinner the other night hearing about what someone made who basically makes commentary for about 3 minutes an hour. And you were outraged.
I got angry.
Now, mind you, it was twice what my peers make in medicine, but go ahead.
Oh,
it's all right.
Twice what your peers make in medicine, please, peers. Anyway, this is a Social Security statement that I get sent once a year. I guess everyone does. Drew, do you get yours?
It
seems like every other year. I never noticed any coming until a few years ago, and now
well,
it's
you
like
never
this...
paid taxes until a few years ago.
Oh, yeah. Maybe this is the second or third one I've gotten, but I find it very interesting. And it starts at the beginning of your recorded work. For me, 1980, must have been at McDonald's in the 10th grade. 1980. Your taxed, my total earnings for 1980, $232.
Who?
Yeah.
Big year.
It's all right. It's all right. Still living at home.
You're 14.
15.
Yeah.
No, maybe in 16. 15. Keeping it real. Living with a stepmom and apathetic dad in North Hollywood.
Crapping in a popcorn tin.
Well, not yet.
Not yet.
Not yet. Right. We're coming to that year. Now, 1981. Starting to move. Starting to move in the right direction. $746.
Ooh, that's a huge move.
It's a decent year. You break that down by month, that's pretty good coin. Pretty good coin. Yeah, working at the Flask Liquor now.
Oh, I didn't hear about this job.
Delivering booze to angry, non-tipping old Jews. Great job. Great gig. Fantastic.
That job must have lost 5 minutes.
Great job. Now, 1982. Graduating high school. Going to work.
What about graduating high school?
Yes, I graduated high school, barely. I didn't get my diploma, but I was able to graduate. Yeah.
Well, you left. You finished high school.
No, I owed the bookroom money, and they wouldn't give me my diploma.
Well, I'm surely that was reflected in your job, your monetary career.
They said I owed them $19.95 for We the People. I argued with them. They said, we're holding your diploma until you give us this book money. And I said, I'll show you. I'll have a endless string of dead-end jobs that don't require a diploma.
Yeah, that must mean that because you didn't have a high school diploma, your income level would be held at the level it was when
How
you left.
How dare you? What do you think? You pull out your high school diploma when you're filling out an application?
Well, let's see what happens to your career here.
I'll show you. 1982, $1,093.
Whoa!
Out on his own, making his way. Well, no, I'm living in the garage. But the stepmom's putting the heat on me now. She's had enough of me bathing off the hose bib outside and crapping in a popcorn tin. So it's time to head out on my own.
Yeah.
1983, that's when I make my move.
Okay.
That's when I strike out, and it's reflecting the income. $2,289, everybody.
Big year.
Yeah. And then, now keep in mind, everybody, not going to college and working summers, just working.
You know what occurs to me right now?
Yeah.
What does it cost the government to keep records of people making no money? There must be a lot of people out there that made no money for many years.
Yeah.
How much does it cost us to keep those records?
I should ask. I'll ask my family. Yeah. Probably, I don't know if they would know that. But all right. Now, smarty pants. Now I've made my move. 1984. I'm in my one-bedroom apartment with the Wheeze.
Wow, already.
Living on Laurel Canyon. Living large. Got myself a futon that we're sharing. Nothing gay. Just proud. Just, making ends meet. $9,367.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. That's 1984, everybody. That's pretty good cash.
Yeah.
I mean, keep in mind, gas was, not $1.65 a gallon back then. It was $1.35.
I want to remind you,
different
too,
time.
We talk to people every night here that have three kids on that salary.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. 1984. 1985? Zero. Just a zero there. See the zero?
This is because you didn't file?
Zero.
Yeah, zero.
I think...
Or are you taking everything in cash that year?
I think I didn't file.
And by the way, if you wonder why the government comes snooping around, it sees a little trend like that. I think it might set up a red flag.
Zero. Yeah. I think I added on my grandmother's kitchen that year. Just took a year off. Need to find myself. Mm. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Plus, when you made $9,367 the year before,
you
can afford to coast for a couple of years. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Sure. All right. So now here's where the move comes here, Drew. 1989. Oh, wait a minute. I'm 86. Sorry. Yeah. 1986, $17,672.
Well, you were getting some skills then.
That's
when you started the carpentry and stuff, right?
Yeah, I'm moving into my carpentry world now. You know, still living under the poverty line, but I got my pride.
Buying your own equipment, probably.
Got my Mazda pickup truck.
So you're reinvesting in yourself as a business, so it's not necessarily all reflected in your Social Security.
I'm making some pretty good coin at this point. I mean, $17,000, That's almost half as much as a school teacher.
You must
so
have
I'm,
tons
I'm doing pretty
of checks
good.
Back then. Tons.
Here's the problem. Quite honestly, I want to be frank with you.
Aside from the money and the car,
I didn't know what they wanted. I didn't know if it was Adam, Adam, you know, the friendly, happy-go-lucky carpenter, or Adam, the $17,672 a year man.
Him.
I didn't know
you
what they wanted.
You couldn't trust them. I
cut a lot of gold diggers out there.
Yeah.
You know what they're going for.
Yeah.
They want to be set up for life.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of bread. Still living in the, now me and the Wheez and another buddy take over a like 900 square foot house in North Hollywood at this point. 1987, took a little slide here, $2,553. Again, and let me just say, this has been out of the house for 4 years now. Not going to school, didn't suffer any back injuries, didn't move back home, just joined the working force. 1987, $2,553. 1988, want to take a guess, Drew?
9,000.
Zero.
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 Was one of these years the ones when you fell off the scaffolding and it couldn't work for a few days?
No.
Can we at least say that?
No, I limped into work the next day.
Okay.
But here we go. And then we're going to take a little break and finish the rest of this off. Zero. Zero 1988. I am an adult now. I've been living out of the house for 4 or 5 years.
Zero really means you didn't file.
Zero means did not file. Mm-hmm. Zero means worked under the table.
Yeah.
That sort of stuff. But didn't get much work under the table.
Right.
And you want to know why I didn't have credit cards?
Yeah. No Social Security.
See the zero there. Yeah. It's hard. That's where you got to do the secured bank. You know, you give the Bank of Hoven $500. They give you $250 credit.
Right.
And it's like, hey, that's great. How hard is that to do? I could give $500
to
my mom
and
tell her just to give me $250 worth of credit. All right. 1990, $6,312. Mm-hmm. We'll stop there. We'll stop there. But remind me to pick it up. Pick it up a little
Rocky
bit later.
Rocky but steady few years there.
Be more fun if Drew brought his in. You guys could compare back and forth the year.
Yeah. Drew wouldn't do it. He's too big a coward.
No, I've never seen that.
You never seen it?
No.
It looks like junk mail. A lot of people just throw it away.
Yeah, I just throw it away, probably.
Yeah, well, it's very interesting. And I don't know, Drew, you got to read it.
Yeah.
I got to see what that's all about. Now, don't give away. No, I won't.
Don't look at it.
It's no fun.
I remember it last year.
You don't remember every number.
No, no, I don't. But let me just.
Hence your $9,000 guess on my pivotal goose egg year of 1987. Now, give me that. Come on, don't make noise into the mic. Now you're going to be bored when I read you the rest of it. You ready to go?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Pfeiffer?
Yeah.
Pfeiffer's ready too, Adam.
You're 16?
Yeah.
What's up?
Okay. Every single time that I make out with my boyfriend, I mean, like, he'll, like, push me off, or he won't even touch me unless he has a boner. I just want to know, is this normal?
I didn't get that. What happens?
He won't touch her unless he has a boner.
Yeah, he won't
maybe,
even touch me.
Or maybe it's just anything. That whenever he's, you know what I mean? Maybe he always has a boner kind of thing.
Well, he doesn't want to make out.
No, he won't even kiss me or anything.
Mm. How old is he?
17.
How often do you guys have sex?
I've never had sex with him.
What do you mean? I don't understand what you're saying.
I don't understand either. Like, every time, like, he won't kiss me at all. Or he won't make out with me or anything unless he has a boner.
But if he starts making out with you, he's going to have a boner. So how can you tell which came first?
I don't know. This is what...
Uh-oh.
How come every 16-year-old chick calls the show sounds like she's wearing a retainer and just bit into something sour, you know? Mm. Key. You know that sound, Drew?
Mm-hmm.
Key. I don't know. That's why I'm, you know, it's like, you're stop and really dissect that question. Every time he kisses me, he has a boner.
Therefore, he wouldn't come at me unless he had one?
Yeah. He's got corneas, too, every time he kisses you. He's got a lot of things. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, Pfeiffer.
Yeah.
What are you? Are you good looking or something?
Not really.
Okay, good. I like that answer. So, we're trying to figure out whether he gets a boner when he's kissing you.
Right.
I don't know.
Which is I know you don't know, but that's a... If he gets a boner when he's making out with you, then he doesn't only come at you when he gets a boner. He gets a boner after he's made out with you.
Which is normal.
Or like, if he loses it, then he'll just want to stop.
You're not doing anything with the guy, but making out.
I know, that's my whole thing. I don't understand.
Do you talk to him about this?
No, I haven't yet. And should I?
I think you're misinterpreting what's going on here. I think there's something normal happening to him, and for some reason you're reading into it.
Why are you spinning this?
I don't know. I just
wanted. What's wrong with you? He's got. I mean, he seems like a decent guy. He's not forcing sex on you.
He's into making out with you, right?
Yeah.
And when he does, he gets a boner, which is normal. I mean, it's almost impossible for a guy not to.
Yeah.
So what's the big deal?
Well, I just he'll.
You sound like her now.
Stop.
What's the big deal?
What's the big deal?
Oh my God.
Yeah. Do you want him to stop?
No, he'll stop right like in the middle.
Like how long before he stops? How long before he stops?
Like, I don't know, like 10 minutes.
Yeah, maybe all I can tolerate.
That's a fair amount of tongue action there.
No,
it's about my yearly quota there now. True, what do you got, 8 minutes? Good. Hey, Pfeiffer.
Yeah.
Where's your dad?
I don't know.
Are you a little angry at the guys or you don't trust them or something?
I just wanted to know.
Do you have any guy friends?
Yeah, I have a lot of guy friends.
Do you ask them?
No, I don't want to embarrass
them. You're not asking a question that a guy can answer.
And it's not a question can answer either. Right. It's a non-question.
You want to know, but what you want to know, what? What
why,
do you want to know?
Why
do guys have boners when they have sex?
Why aren't you having sex with a guy?
Because I just don't want to.
That's good.
Okay.
That's good. That's excellent.
Where's your dad?
I honestly don't know. He left when I was two.
Yeah.
Okay, so you got weird trust issues here with guys.
Okay.
Because, listen, Fiverr, this guy's not doing anything. He's making out with you for 10 minutes, which is a fairly long make-out session. He's getting an erection, and then he's not forcing himself on you.
Yeah,
just like every other teenage guy.
Goes as far as he can, then he kind of gets less excited.
He's
out of steam.
He's a model citizen by Loveline standards. And you're trying to create some case against him, and you don't have anything to go off of. So just stop building a case against him and his boner.
Okay.
All right, you're angry at your dad. You don't trust your dad. You were hurt by your dad. That's your dad. This guy's not your dad. Okay?
All right.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I like that Pfeiffer.
Yeah.
She's like, all right.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you,
Mr. Corolla. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A little more of that would be nice.
Yeah.
Ariel? Is it Ariel?
Ariel.
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 Ariel. All right.
All right, who cares?
Yeah. Go ahead.
What do you want?
Okay. I'm Chaldean. Okay. I don't know if you know what it is.
That's a skin lotion, right?
I'm from Iraq.
Yeah. Chaldean.
But I'm Catholic.
Chaldean.
You're Catholic.
Yeah.
All right. When did you come to this country?
In 1983.
Okay.
All right.
Moved to Detroit.
Oh, boy.
My family moved from Iraq to Detroit.
Only city in the United States worse than Iraq.
Detroit. No,
yes.
Only city.
Yeah.
It could still be a lateral move from Iraq.
Detroit is a good place.
All right, go ahead.
Anyway, my family is very strict. Like, we're like Muslims as far as our culture, like towards women. And I'm supposed to have like an arranged marriage or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But I ended up having sex when I was 20 years old.
Huh, that's not bad.
The black guy.
Fantastic.
That was a big deal in my house.
That was a big deal?
Oh, yeah. Well, they didn't know I had sex with a black guy, but they knew I dated a black guy.
All right, well, payback time. You declared a jihad on your...
on my own family,
On your dad, yeah, that's great.
Right.
And
right.
They didn't like this? Did they meet this guy ever?
They met him, and they didn't like him.
Oh,
I'm
feeling so sorry for this poor guy.
They had no reason not to like him.
You know, you can imagine what he was dealing with?
Yes, and I can imagine.
He was probably a good guy. Probably was.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, he was a good guy. He still is a good guy.
Yeah.
Right.
No, not all right.
We have one Arab caller calls on once every 5 years. That's him, and he yells at me. All right, so you dated the one black guy.
I dated the black guy, and I was sexually active. And, you know, in my culture, we have arranged marriages. My brother got married like that. My sister, she's a year older than me.
Yada, yada, yada.
Yada, yada, yada. Anyway, it's a point in time right now. It's like, okay, my mom wants me to get married now. But I can't because I'm not a virgin anymore.
Well, what? Whoever they're setting you up with won't accept you if you're not a virgin?
Oh, yeah. They won't accept me. And we do the whole shindig, bring out the sheets. Let's see what's going on.
Oh, really? Who does that?
The family does. His family comes to my house when I get married.
Well, okay. Hold on. Have you found Have you found the young suitor yet? I mean, do you know the guy?
Yeah, my mom has found the young
suitor. If she's hot, it will not matter to him.
I don't want
to
marry him.
Guaranteed.
Do you know?
I'm still interested in this black guy.
Have you met? You have met him.
Yeah, I have met him.
What's he do?
I don't like him.
What's he do?
He owns a liquor store.
Oh, boy.
Well, listen, let's be honest. I've said this many times, and people don't appreciate this, but some cultures are clearly better than other cultures, let's face it. The ones where you denigrate and beat the chicks.
Well, they're finally...
Worse culture than our culture. I'm going way out on a limb in saying that here, Drew, where you beat the ladies. Shut up, Drew. I'm tired of you defending
I'm not
going
to defend it. I'm just
going
to say people are beginning to analyze this in the terms of what they're calling normative abuse.
Yeah.
And some cultures make abuse normative.
Yeah.
And this is what that is.
Yeah. Well,
if I left my house with somebody else.
Yeah, listen, who wants to marry a guy from this?
My ties to my family.
You don't want to marry a guy from your culture because he's going to degrade you.
No, I'm not going to say he would degrade me. My sister married a wonderful man.
He did? She did?
Yeah, my brother's a wonderful man, and he has a good wife, but I'm just not. Yeah,
arranged marriages can work. Amazing.
Well,
my mom and dad have an arranged marriage. They were married for 36 years. My dad just passed away a month ago.
Oh.
And so, I know it can work.
No, are you kidding? So he met her old boyfriend.
He met. That's how he died. Died of a massive corner.
Yeah.
Hello, I'm Lucius. Hello, Mr. Osama Bin Laden. I'm Lucius. And he just fell over right on the floor. All right, Drew. How dare you make these stereotypes, Drew? Is that what killed him? Drew's laughing his ass off. No, that's Drew, please. How dare you? Ariel?
Yes?
All right. I'm sorry for Drew's behavior.
Yeah, I have a very political last name. You better be careful.
I know. No, your dad.
You're very what?
I said I have a very political last name. You better be careful.
Political.
Sounds like saying
my
essay.
My last name's Arafat.
Oh, really?
Oh, really?
Oh,
yeah,
man.
But I'm not related. I'm from Iraq. He's from Palestine.
All right. Well, anyway, look, I do agree with Drew and you, and we've shouted that on this show many a time, which is arranged marriages last longer because when you're able to pick your own partner, you go to the dark side, the sick side, oftentimes,
right.
And you'd be better off. We just spun a wheel.
Yeah. Look, our parents are trying to make an objective decision.
Okay, there's no doubt that if you married this guy, it might last 100 years. But the point is you don't want to do this.
Yeah.
And let me say this. I don't know if you got the huevos to say this to your parents, but why did you guys come here?
To be away from Saddam Hussein.
Okay, so here's the thing. Everybody comes to this country, and yet they want to cling on to their culture, which everyone says is fine. I think it's ridiculous. You left your country because it was an oppressive culture, and you wanted this culture. So if you're going to do it, do it.
So if I do it, and I tear all my ties with my family, then
I think you can call. Here's the thing. If they truly love you, And they truly have feelings for you, they will not sever all ties with you.
Just because you don't want to get married. Why don't you focus on not getting married now?
I don't have to get married now, but I don't want to be in a relationship with a Chaldean guy.
I know. So just let that be your battlefield right now. Not marriage, not now, not a relationship. That's all. Just state it clearly and see if you can get them to calm down. You can go on about your life. All right?
No, not all right.
All right, we'll see. Oh my!
All right, now what do you think of the war?
I agree with Bush.
You want to get Saddam out of there?
Yes, he killed my uncle.
Ooh. He did.
Yeah.
I have some Chaldean patients, and they just said it was just unbelievably horrible.
Yeah.
The Chaldeans terrible. Were especially oppressed, though, weren't they?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's the guy needs to die. He just needs to die.
Bush is also, he's not righteous in saying that he can go in a country where that somebody else runs and thinks that he could just take him out of there. He's not God.
Yeah, well, what do you want? You want another 30 years of vicious oppression?
I mean, they're over there, they're doing their thing. Obviously, the people can't stand up to him. Why should we? We have our own problems over here.
Mm. Well, what do you want then? You want the rest of your family to get killed by this guy?
Leave. There's political asylum. You could leave. We left.
Yeah, but not every. First off, not everyone has the option of just picking up and leaving their country.
No, but if his own people wouldn't stand behind him so tough, then they could get him out of the regime. I mean, like, out of his political.
Well, yeah, I agree. I think it'd be nice if people stood up, but there's a certain point when the horse gets out of the barn, and if you're as maniacal as he is, and is paranoid as he is, by all accounts, this is Saddam Hussein. Every time there's the even inkling or just a little ripple of a coup, you just viciously kill everybody. It's hard to get something off the ground. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And I think that's what's going on, or what has been going on there for many years. All right. Well, good times.
And in order to leave a country, they'd have to take their whole family with them, and organizing that, and, you know, getting everybody to go. Because anyway,
well, and where are you going, and what's your plan? The entire country leaves Iraq and goes where? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Who's going to have them? Yeah. And the beauty of that part of the world, it's not the Mr. Rogers' neighborhood over there. Everyone magically hates each other. I wonder what that is. Well, we're all just different, beautiful cultures. That's all we got to remember, everybody. Just different, not bad, just different.
LoveLine, we'll be right back. Call them at 1-800-LOVE-191.
Half of all new HIV infections in this country happen to people under the age of 25. Protect yourself. Call toll-free 1-866-344-KNOW.
Right now would be a good time to come into Napa Auto Parts, because Napa Premium Motor Oil is just 99 cents a quart. Napa Motor Oil is manufactured to the highest industry standards. This is the good stuff. Hey, if you change your oil every 3,000 miles, you're our kind of people. If you're going to go longer between changes, an oil this good is even more important. And at just 99 cents a quart, this is a great time to pick some up.
Get the good stuff.
Napa, get the good stuff.
This is Rocky Moselle of International Star Registry. For birthdays, holidays, or any occasion, give the gift that is never forgotten. Name a star after someone. For $48 and a call to 800-282-3333, or visit starregistry.com, the Star Registry will name a star after anyone you choose and send a beautiful personalized gift. The new star name will be recorded in book form in the U.S. Copyright Office. Call the Star Registry at 800-282-3333, or visit starregistry.com for the gift that shines forever.
Every day, 10 children are killed by gunfire.
Where have all the children gone? Long time passing.
Where have all the children gone? Long time ago.
Where have all the children gone? Gone to graveyards one by one.
Oh, when will we?
Oh, when will we ever learn?
The killing won't stop unless you help stop it. Call 1-800-WE-PREVENT to find out what you can do. Not one more lost life. Not one more grieving family. Not one more.
Oh, when will we ever learn?
A public service message from the U.S. Department of Justice, the Crime Prevention Coalition, and the Ad Council.
Hi, this is Mike Mills
and Peter Buck of REM.
For RAD, Rockers Against Drunk Driving. You know, it's okay to rock and roll and party. Just let someone else do the driving. Please don't drink and drive, and don't drive with someone else who's been drinking. Thank you.
What's the frequency? Can at the shop and to drink?
Hey, what are you doing after the game?
Well, there's a big party at Jason's. His parents are out of town, and there's going to be plenty to drink.
I think I'll pass.
You're going to pass up a party?
Well, it sounds more like trouble than a party.
Make the right choice. Underage drinking always means trouble. It's dumb, dangerous, and illegal.
You're going to miss all the fun.
I'm going to stay out of trouble.
A public service message from the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
If you're between the ages of 12 and 18, you're invited to play our Name That Theme Song Challenge. Just listen to the following songs and try to identify the popular TV shows they come from. Number one. Number two.
Come and knock on our door.
Come and knock on our door.
We've been waiting for you.
We've been waiting for you.
Three.
Please come back.
It's the bigger love.
Four.
Give it up, give it up.
You got to give it up on the brother.
And five.
Sweet Valley, Sweet Valley.
If you can name two, you know your TV. If you can name three, you're a certified TV master. If you can name four or more, you probably need to get off the couch and get outside.
Run, walk, jump, pedal, paddle, blade, board, kick, dribble, spike, get up, get out.
A public service message brought to you by the President's Council on Physical Fitness and Sports and the Ad Council.
Hey, everybody, it's LoveLine. I'm Adam. That's Dr. Drew.
Did you take all those almonds to the office? We got them here tonight. You got them here?
Buried them here somewhere.
All right. Lauren.
No, you taking those out, Drew?
The almonds.
I'm going to average 750 smoked almonds a night until those two cases are depleted, Drew.
You got to mention Meza Inc. Meza Inc.
M-E-Z-Z-A.
Yeah,
they sent us all these almonds. But, Drew, this sent us this says $22 worth of almonds. You don't have to give a plug every single night.
Well, but it was such listen, it's not the amount, it's the, how can I say this, the joy this gift has brought us.
I agree too, but it sets a dangerous precedent when people send us $11 worth of crap and we give them a plug every night.
Right. Plus it's brought me no joy next time, like send yogurt or something that's loud and horrible on my ears.
Yeah. No. Plus, we shouldn't tell people we eat stuff that they send to us.
Yeah.
Thank you, Brian.
Thank you.
Drew's going to get into that. Oh, no. The Sultan over here needs a little coffee refill, too, while his lady in waiting is over here bringing him his smoked nuts. All right, you ready to roll here, Drew?
Yep.
Kevin.
Yeah.
You're 17?
Yeah.
What's up?
All right, well, this girl I know, she has herpes. And she wants to have sex, and I'm not sure, like, what the risks are and if I should or if I shouldn't.
You know, there's a question I don't usually ask that I should, which is how long has she had it for?
What was it?
How long has she had it for?
I think maybe, like, a month or 2 months.
She's recently contracted it.
Yeah.
All right, earlier on in the infection, people tend to be more contagious.
Okay.
They tend to have more frequent outbreaks, more robust outbreaks, create more virus. Is she on medication for it?
Yeah, pretty sure.
Okay, so that'll suppress some of that viral production. And then you can wear a condom. That can make it even safer.
Genital herpes?
I don't know. She just told me it was herpes.
I imagine that's what she's talking about.
Yeah.
That's people mean when they're talking about that.
How old is she?
She's 18.
All right.
And if she has no symptoms and she's on antiviral medication, risks, and you wear a condom, it's a reasonably safe thing to do, but it's impossible to be completely safe with herpes. You can always contract it somewhere.
Drew, what about what I do before I'm with the hooker? I hit my dork with Raid. You know what I mean?
Yeah, Raid.
Sprite down with Raid, nutsack, pubes, a-hole, whole area in there. Sometimes I'll let a fogger go off my underpants.
Fogger in the ass?
No,
underpants. I don't think it'll do too much. No.
You don't think I would do it, huh?
It's good times, though,
No. All right. Let's talk to Jake, who's 16. Jake?
Yeah.
What's up?
I had a question for Dr. Drew, and my question was if you hold back your ejaculation to make your orgasm last longer in the same way you could hold back a pee stream, would that be bad for you, like in your...
Well, first of all, it will not make your orgasm last longer, okay?
Well,
your orgasm
how
lasts
can you hold
less.
It back the same way you hold back a pee stream?
Well, you could. Some people can contract a muscle in there that will kind of... hold it back temporarily, but it will come.
Yeah, then it just leaks out later.
It leaks out, exactly. Basically, that's right.
Like something you left in the car.
And it's not as though you're going to explode or have a serious medical problem. It's not the healthiest thing you can do for your outflow.
You're 16. Where are you going? Who are you satisfying?
Well,
He just wants a longer orgasm.
He wants to beat off longer, right?
So maybe wait longer in between beating off, and you'll have a longer orgasm, more intense.
Or do what I do, beat off more often.
Yeah, because I read this in Maxim magazine.
Right. Yeah, Maxim magazine. Right.
Yeah. And it just said it makes it last longer.
Yeah.
Right. Well, it doesn't.
All right.
But you want to tell us where you read that again?
Maxim.
Maxim. All right. You have a girlfriend, Jake?
No.
No?
Work on that. That'll make you happier.
Shocking. All right. And listen, you people out there who read things, I used to think that, okay, if you saw something on TV or maybe in a tabloid, you couldn't believe it. But if you read it in a magazine or a newsprint, it was true. Wait till they start writing articles about you. And not just lies. I just mean factually screwed up, wrong.
Yeah.
Three cores of the stuff. Just flat out wrong. Like if you were there, you knew what was going on. You just
wrong. People interview you. You tell them some things and they twist the facts, or they do research on you and screw that all up.
Not only that, just flat out screw ups all the time. Like in the newspaper, the other day they were doing a thing on great April Fool's pranks over the years, and they cited K-Rock, the mother station out here, Kevin and Bean, the morning show, for doing some good pranks over the years that Jimmy used to be involved with, and now Ralph and all that kind of stuff. And they had this one that they cited where one of the guys from the morning show got in a fight with the lead singer from Radiohead, and that was the big thing. And they said that Bean got in the fight with what's-his-nose from Radiohead, and Jimmy and I were reading the article the other day, and we both looked at each other and said, Kevin got in a fight with him.
Oh, yeah.
Bean didn't get in a fight with him. Now, I wasn't through an interview. It's just they're wrong.
Right.
They screwed up. It's not, if you're reading it, it's not that big a deal. But if you know the guys, it doesn't make sense.
But it's all the time.
All the time.
Yeah, that's just one little tiny itsy-bitsy example.
No, if someone wrote an article about you in the newspaper and you read it, they would have a couple of dates screwed up.
They'd have your name spelled wrong, the way you went to school would be wrong. Who they interviewed, the teacher, whatever.
When
wrong
they
name,
ask you, like, how you met this or how you got into that, that would be screwed up. So everything you read, look at it as three-quarter factual, unless it's the Bible.
And then if it's editorial, if it's somebody's opinion.
Well, then you can decide to agree with it or not. Desiree?
Yeah.
You're 18?
Yeah.
Mom was laid off again.
Yeah.
Thinks she's suicidal. She's depressed. She cries a lot.
Cries a lot, sleeps a lot.
Yeah. Has she expressed suicidal thoughts?
Not to me or my sister, but I'm pretty sure she's thinking about them.
Well, how did you get that impression without her telling you?
Well, I have depression myself, and so I know, like, what it's like to be there, and just, like, the way that she's acting and stuff, she's, like, never happy, always crying.
Yeah, we get that she's depressed, but suicidal
thoughts.
All right,
Drew, get off that part. I mean, she's not suicidal.
Yeah.
But Liz, how old is she?
Like 45.
Because here's the thing. Drew, stop me if I'm wrong here, but 45-year-old women don't usually squeeze a trigger.
No, that's true.
They're just depressed.
They take pills once in a while, but that's...
Yeah.
When they have kids to take care of, they usually pay attention to that. They don't do it.
Yeah. Yeah, but Desiree?
Yeah.
So your mom's depressed, and you're depressed. And that's sad, because my mom was depressed, too, and it was a bummer.
What kind of work did she do?
She did permitting for, like, oil companies and, like, land use permitting.
Where's your dad?
Oregon.
And you're in Alaska?
Yeah.
Was she running away from him?
No. Like, when I was 4, he was an abusive alcoholic.
Well, then she wouldn't run away from him.
No.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Why'd she go to Alaska?
Because this is where all our family is.
Okay.
Okay, so here's the thing. Your mom is depressed. You can try to get her to some help or suggest some help, but you cannot be responsible for her.
And she should get help, but she doesn't have to suffer like this. There are things
but you don't have to suffer like this either, though. I mean, you're 18.
Right.
You planning on going to college or getting a job at a seal blubber rendering plant or something? I don't know what the big work is up there.
I work at a daycare center.
Daycare for seals?
No, care for
seals. I don't understand. I don't understand. Let's move on. Do you work daycare? You have a good job? You like it?
Yeah.
You like the kids?
I love the kids.
Yeah.
No, that's nice. Okay, so listen, if you got a job where you love the people you work with, or work for, or work on, that's pretty good.
See, Adam has trouble empathizing if someone is not describing an experience that he's had. And when he was depressed, he hated his work. Yeah. And that's what made it especially painful for him.
Listen, Jack Hole, I'm saying to you, Drew, that at 18 to 30, let's call it 18 to 25, 26, most young people have crappy jobs.
Yeah,
they just do. They work in the mailroom. They work long hours. They work as like assistants or receptionists or laborers or whatever, and their jobs suck.
Yep.
And if you got a job at 18 that you can go to that you really dig, that you're kind of ahead of the game there.
Yep.
So, Desiree.
Yeah.
And why don't you look at moving out of the house and getting your crap together?
I am out of the house. I live down the road from her.
Oh, okay.
But, yeah. Well, the thing is that she's on medication. She's on antidepressants.
What's she taking?
Effexor.
All right. You know how much she's taking?
I think she's taken 150.
All right. That's a sort of an average / smaller dose. And you call her doctor and let him know that she's still, or she, he or she know that she's not doing well. See if they change that.
She doctor. Come on, Drew. Get serious. All right. I think when we come back, I'm going to read more from my Social Security statement.
Ooh, yay.
Yeah. That's my total earnings for the year since I started working up until present. And I don't know where we left off, Drew. Was it 1988 with the big fat zero?
Yeah. This kind of reminds me of the Andy Kaufman film when he gets up and reads, what was it, a Faulkner novel or something?
Whatever.
Yeah.
All right. We'll take a quick break. We'll be back.
Loveline.
1-800-LOVE-191.
We'll be right back.
Ten kids die by gunfire every day. Help stop the violence. Call 1-800-WE-PREVENT. Not one more lost life. Not one more.
Was blind, but now I see.
A public service message from this station, the U.S. Department of Justice, the Crime Prevention Coalition, and the Ad Council.
Mommy! Mommy!
It's all right. Daddy's here.
Where's Mommy?
Mommy doesn't feel well.
Sick so much, Daddy.
I don't know, honey.
Alcoholism affects your family, your friends, your job, all the things that are important to you.
I want Mommy to be the way she used to be.
Me too.
Alcoholism is a treatable disease. Get help before you lose the really important things in life. A public service message from the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Yo, I'm Alfonso Ribeiro for RAD. Hey, partying's a good time, have fun, but you don't have to get in the car and do it. Get a taxi, get a limo, get whatever you want, get a friend, get home safely. Don't drink and drive.
Hey, Larry, you think we'll ever have a baby?
Vince, we're crash dummies.
Yeah, but your head's about the size of a baby. Here, give it to me, will you?
What are you doing?
I'm taking it off! Oh, I'm using your head in the rear-facing infancy. Up in front, kids won't know what hit them in the air.
Where are we going, Vince?
You know that brick wall with the big bullseye?
Sure, like the back of my...
Holy cow, Larry, you're embedded in the seat.
Tire iron.
I can't understand you. I'll go get a tire iron.
Thank you.
You could learn a lot from a dummy. Buckle your kids in the back seat. A message from the Department of Transportation and the Ad Council.
What's up? This is Warren G, you know what I'm saying? I'm here giving it up for RAD because they do a lot of good things for people. And I just want to say, before you drink, make sure that you got somebody that can drive your butt home so you won't crash or get pulled over and get a DUI. So go ahead and follow the rules.
We're just trying to make you see. Nobody does it better.
Yo, this is Lamont Bentley with a message from RAD. Now listen up. I
know that you're young, and I know that you love to party. But when you party, don't be selfish. Don't drink and drive.
Living in a world like this one, it's hard to feel. You can't change it, but we must try.
Hi, I'm Malik Yoba, and I play a cop on TV. I wrote this song because I need to see things change. Too many kids are dying in our streets from violence. I know because I was shot when I was 15. I survived, but each day there are 10 kids that don't, and we can do something if we just try. Be brave enough to walk away from violence and those that push it. Make a pledge to yourself to turn away from guns as a solution to solve your conflict. You can find smart, peaceful ways to settle arguments. I survived getting shot, but not everyone does. Don't let it happen to you.
All you have to do is try.
A message from the U.S. Department of Justice, the Crime Prevention Coalition, and the Ad Council.
Hey, everybody, it's LoveLine. I'm Adam. That's Dr. Drew. Phone number, 1-800-LOVE-191. So I was down at the Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach, and finally get to racing this week, doing some practice.
On the street?
Yeah, the track is the street. Well, it's a bunch of streets that are barricaded off, cement barricades.
How was it?
It was interesting. No, but it was interesting racing with cement. You know, the barricades are 18 inches off the track. You know, so if you get loose, you just hit this concrete in a lot of places. So it's kind of hairy, but it was kind of fun. It's kind of fun going 110 miles an hour on Shoreline Drive, which is probably a 35 mile an hour street. You know, you get to drive on the public streets, and sometimes the signals are on too, so you get to go through.
That's weird.
You go through red lights.
It's like a video game.
Yeah, yeah. It really is like one of those video games. And like I said, those Grand Prix, you know, sort of like, I guess Miami's probably a lot like it. Whenever they do a Grand Prix course in the city, all they can do is put up a bunch of cement barriers and then put a bunch of tires, in certain corners and things like that. But it was fun. Aldrin ruined his car.
Is that it? Is he out then once you run a car?
No, gets another car.
So, your Social Security statement.
Huge feet, that Buzz Aldrin.
Big hands, too, right?
Big hands, big feet. I'm guessing big lunar lander. You know what I'm saying there, buddy? Yeah. The eagle has landed. All right.
I want to hear your numbers.
Oh, my numbers. Yeah. I was thinking maybe we'd do that in the 11 o'clock
hour. All right, that's fine.
Oh, so fast?
We only got a few minutes here to take calls.
Yeah, you're right. All right, let's go. Jill?
Yeah.
What's the matter, baby doll?
You guys are going to think I'm stupid. Yeah. My problem is that this kid that I know, he uses needles, and I've shared with him before.
Shared needles?
Yeah.
And what drug are you guys using?
Heroin.
All right. That's not stupid. That's a serious disease.
And it's
showing you how serious it is by how reckless your behavior has become. The drive to use the drug has taken over your even desire to survive. It's just superseded that.
Yeah. I mean, I don't use it on a regular basis.
Well, it's addiction. You don't have to use it regularly. Addiction is defined by consequences.
Hold on. Any chick who's using the rig is addicted, please.
And using regularly is not what defines addiction. Addiction is defined by consequences.
Women don't take needles unless they're into it.
Yeah. And I've been going to NA and stuff.
Good. All right.
I mean, a while ago, he shared with this one lady, and she has hepatitis B or something, but he cleaned the needle with bleach.
That's not that the needle isn't the problem. It's you draw up when you're finding the vein that pulls blood into the drug.
Yeah.
And that's where you get the virus.
Not off the needle?
Uh-uh.
Why not?
Because you're pulling, you're pulling stuff.
Yeah, but
up
you
in
would, you would get it off the needle.
Yeah, the needle.
They clean it off.
Yes, the needle also. Right.
Yeah, so it's better than nothing. Jill.
Yeah.
Why? You think you have it?
I'm not sure.
Well, you gotta get checked, right?
Is it B or C that she has, or both?
I'm not sure.
All right, it's probably C. I mean, that's the IV drug user's hepatitis these days.
Oh, okay.
You can get vaccinated against B, and B usually you get sick when you get. So you haven't been sick lately, right?
No.
C you just get, and the problem with C is that it causes cancer and things. And
well, when did you find out about this?
I don't know, not too long ago.
All right. Well, what's the matter? Beside this.
Well, it's a heroin addict.
Well, all right.
Yeah. Beside that. Huh?
Well, I mean, you're
a heroin addict 16. It also means you're a trauma survivor. So she had something awful happen to her growing up, also, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What happened to you?
My sister was a heroin addict, and she she screwed over my family really bad.
That doesn't seem like enough. How was your family?
My family's fine.
How is it that they had two heroin addict daughters?
Yeah.
Just luck of the draw?
I guess.
Anyway, listen.
Well, we got some insight.
Jill, here's the deal. You need medically managed treatment. You've been going to NA. That's great. It's not been enough. And you now sort of, because of the progression of your disease, in spite of going to NA, you've endangered your life. That means it's not working. It's time to get some real help, get some professional help. And in the course of that, get the hepatitis titers, see what the situation is with your liver. Maybe it's fine. B and C are treatable conditions. Well, they can be treated anyway. But pretty much no one's going to treat you until you've been sober 6 months. So let's get with the program, get going. You're going to need to be in a structured environment for quite a while.
All right. And good times. Justin?
Hello?
Justine.
Oh, yes. Justine. All
Thank
right.
You
I missed
so
the
much.
Either.
Hello?
Thank you so much.
Thank what? You so much for taking my call. Thank you so much.
What's up, Justine?
All right. Basically, this is going to sound kind of ridiculous, but I have this friend that I met at a dance, and I got his number.
Uh-huh.
It was just a school dance, and I called him, and we talked, and he's really nice, but he's really cool. He's one of those, like, perfect guys, and you know what I mean.
Yeah, how old, really now cool. You're 13, how old is he?
He's 14.
He's 14.
Yeah.
All right.
What's cool about him?
What's perfect about him?
Perfect about him.
Black Reno polish?
He's just a total ladies man. He's
he's the way he handles his peachy folder, the way Parks is chopper-oo.
Yes, he's poet, writer. I know.
He winds his beanie to the left.
Pardon?
Okay. So.
Anyway, so I really liked him, and then I decided
Hold on a second. I like to watch a phone screener Brian explain physically the jokes to junior producer Lauren. I said, he winds his beanie to the left, and then there was a little confusion, and I noticed Brian explaining the joke.
Actually showing the beanie being spun, yeah?
Yeah, yeah. All right. Hi, Justine. Sorry about that.
All right. Also, I forgot to say thank you so much for doing everything you guys do on the show. I think it's awesome.
Thank you, Jane. You know what's nice about Jane? Justine has a nice observing side of her, she can look at herself, laugh at herself. Oh. I know this is silly, but
she's
there
good.
I am.
She's good people. She's good
there
people.
I am.
I love you guys too. All right. This is where it starts to get interesting. So I decided, all right, this guy, I don't have a chance with him. It's not that I have lowest self-esteem or anything. So I called him back about 2.5 months later, and you're going to think I'm a total psycho, but I said, hey, I'm not going to say his name because you guys flip out when people say people's names.
Right.
I said, hi, it's me. And he's like, who's me? And I'm like, well, you know who I am. He's like, no, I don't. I was like, oh, I'm your guardian angel. And he's like, okay. So even though he doesn't really know who I am, we became like super, super good friends. And so now I'm totally, totally into him.
Mm-hmm. Just over the phone?
Well, yeah, but I also see him like at dances and stuff.
Isn't he interested in finding out who you are?
Does he? Oh, yeah, totally. He's like, yeah, we have to go hang out, you know. And
But he knows you also.
Yeah.
So he's going to be disappointed, you think?
Well, that's kind of why I called the show, is because I decided I'm going to see him on Friday at a dance, another dance, and I invited him as the normal me, the normal Justine, not the angel Justine.
Wow.
Yeah, but doesn't he recognize your voice?
Yeah, well, that's the weird thing. That's the thing about, like, I know, Drew, you're good at, you know, recognizing people's voices, but, you know, I was kind of like, you know, guys never, like, I can call a guy one night, the next night call and be someone else, and they don't even notice. I'm like, what's wrong with you?
Yeah, they're 14, 15,
yeah.
Yeah. So I was wondering if we could call him.
Tonight?
If I could tell him how I feel.
Tonight?
Tonight, yeah. On air.
Yeah.
I could tell him how I feel, and you guys could, like, guide me along, and, you know. I don't know.
Or I could sit here for an hour and read my Social Security statement. You have his home number.
Yes.
You think he's awake?
Yeah, his parents are probably going to be cool. I'll probably have to apologize and everything, but.
All right. Well, let us take a break, and
we'll talk about it amongst ourselves.
We'll convene,
yeah.
Which means me watch Drew take a leak and eat more of these smoked almonds and then forget about it. But hang on, Justine.
Hang on.
I like that little spark plug known as Justine.
We'll see.
Hey, I think we'll try this.
All right.
We'll take a break. We'll be back.
Here it is. Bottom line, it sucks being single today. Tons of lame people and no decent prospects. Call the Dateline. Call the Dateline. Call the Dateline. 1-877-889-DATE. LoveLine! LoveLine will be right back, so get your problems ready. Ready.
Okay, people, come on, settle down, settle down. Everyone settle down. Joanne DiCarlo.
Present.
William Robertson.
Here.
Raymond Vega.
Yeah, I'm here.
Peter Lawrence. John Earhart. Marona Maxwell. Andrea Thompson. Andrea Thompson.
Every day, 10 children are killed by gunfire. 10 dead kids. 10 kids too many. The violence won't stop until you help stop it. To find out how, call 1-800-WE-PREVENT for free information. That's 1-800-WE-PREVENT. And please call today. Not one more lost life. Not one more grieving family. Not one more. A public service message from this station, the U.S. Department of Justice, the Crime Prevention Coalition, and the Ad Council.
Hello, my name is Rome, and I'm here for RAD. Music is very important to me, but what's most important is life. Please, please choose a designated driver. Don't drink and drive.
You put the spell on me. I'm hooked, baby. Crazy love.
What'll it be, lady?
You think you might be pregnant. You need to see your doctor. You want to tell your family, and you need to stop drinking alcoholic beverages. The best choice for you and your baby is to stop drinking and call your doctor for advice.
Congratulations. You were right. You're pregnant.
If you have questions about drinking during your pregnancy, ask your doctor. Be good to your baby right from the start. A public service message from the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Hey, this is Kate Pearson from the B-52s. For RAD, getting drunk is your own business, but when you drive drunk, you make it everybody's business. Don't drink and drive. Be responsible, plan ahead, and choose a designated driver. Remember, music lives, and so should you.
Hey, Larry, baby, you want to go for a ride?
Why, Vince, I didn't know you cared.
I don't, but I'm looking for a baby.
But, Vince, we're crash dummies.
Well, your head's about the size of a baby. What are you doing? Taking it off!
Ah!
I'm using your head in a rear-facing infancy.
Why?
To show how babies up front are in airbag danger.
You know I get sick when I ride backwards and without a body.
Up in front, kids won't know what hit them when the airbag blows.
Then why do people put their kids up front, Vince?
I don't know. Maybe it makes them feel better to see them sitting by their side, although... if my baby looked like you, he'd ride in the truck.
Hey, where are we going, Vince?
Yeah, you know that brick wall with the big bullseye?
I can see it vaguely in the back of my mind.
Well, in 2 seconds, that's exactly where it's going to be. Holy cow, Larry, you're embedded in the seat.
Tire iron.
I can't understand you. I'll go get a tire iron.
Thank you.
You could learn a lot from a dummy. Buckle your kids in the back seat. A message from the Department of Transportation and the Ad Council.
Hi, this is Dennis Franz of NYPD Blue for RAD, recording artists, actors, and athletes against drunk driving. My character, Andy Sipwitz, has learned that there are a lot of things in life you have no control over. Fortunately, driving drunk isn't one of them. If you drink, don't drive. Choose a designated driver, and if one of your friends has been drinking, get the keys. Friends don't let friends drive drunk.
A message from the Department of Transportation, Ad Council, National Association of Broadcasters, and RAD.
Did you hear what Smokey said? Did you hear what Smokey said?
I want to know if you heard what Smokey said. Smokey said only you.
This is Marty Stewart from my pal Smokey Bear, reminding you if you must burn debris or trash, do it safely. Check local laws on burning and never burn on dry when you date. Remember, only you can prevent forest fires.
Smokey didn't mention nobody else. Smokey said only you.
This message from the USDA Forest Service and your state forester and advertising council.
Listen up. This is the fact. 1 in 2. That's how many new HIV infections occur among people under the age of 25 in this country. 1/2. To know more about how to protect yourself, call toll-free 1-866-344-KNOW. We now return you to your regularly scheduled life.
Hey everybody, it's LoveLine. I'm Adam, that's Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. All right, when we left off, we're speaking to young, sparky little Justine. Justine is 13.
We also have Joseph on the phone, holding, listening.
Yeah, but we're going to talk to Justine for a second first. Justine met a guy, liked the guy.
Joseph's holding. You want to?
No.
He's holding.
I don't care.
I'm going to spill the whole thing before she has a chance to talk to him?
She was supposed to tell him.
Well, I'm not. Okay, I won't give it away.
All right.
But I want to talk to Justine because, you're saying Joseph can hear us?
Yeah.
Okay. Good point. Here's my point, though. I'm not so sure about this Justine. A little too confident here.
Okay.
Why is your plan to do this with us? What do you need us for?
First of all, I listen to you guys all the time, and I just think you guys have a way of doing things that are special. All the other hotlines.
All right, good enough. That's all we need. I just need a little ass.
Wait, I'm.
Now what I do? Just press.
I'm trying
press.
Not to kiss up. I'm
hold
trying
on, just
okay.
Here,
that's good. That's good.
When I like.
Here we go.
That's
there
good.
We
that's
go. There we go.
Down. Okay. Joseph.
Yes.
Hi.
Hey.
It's Angel.
I know.
Did they tell you?
Yes, they did.
Who? What?
I didn't tell them anything.
Hey, Adam.
Wait.
No one told you anything.
Well, no one told me. Okay. Do you know what you're on, like, on right now?
Yeah, no.
Okay.
Kind of weird.
What yeah. Else? Well, you're on LoveLine, and...
Do we need to apologize to his parents, or no, we're okay that way?
Wait, what is it?
Do we need to apologize to his parents, or we're all right?
That's cool.
All right.
Hey, what's up, Adam and Drew?
What's happening there, Joe? Joe, how old are you? How old are you?
14.
She only hangs out with overconfident people, seems like. Doesn't
yeah. It? Yeah. I don't know why we got 13 up there, but, all right, so go ahead, Angel.
Well, okay, Adam.
Yeah. Help her, Adam.
How should I be original?
Well, first off, I got 4 hours sleep last night, so I'm a little out of it. Secondly, I'm only so interested in what goes on this show, so I was only listening with, like, one ear. When you told me that Joseph knows you by two names.
Yes.
And why? Well, should we tell Joseph those two names?
Yeah, go for it.
Okay, those names are Angel.
Right, Joseph?
As his angel.
Yeah.
Okay.
And Justine.
Yeah.
Do you know that is the same person?
Yeah.
You do?
Now he knows, yeah.
But did you know before tonight?
Yeah, I did.
You did?
I thought I had you going pretty well for a while.
Yeah, you did.
Well, yeah, I did.
All right, let's cut to the chase. Joseph, are you interested in Justine or Angel?
Yeah.
You are?
Totally.
You'd like to go on a date with her?
I don't know. I think you're just like, oh, I'm so happy. You have no idea.
Well, Well, wait a minute. But you guys have been talking for months now.
Yeah, but she was afraid to always.
I've liked you the entire time. I am like totally like.
Justine, don't give up the ship yet. Hold on a second.
Yeah, right. Slow down.
Yeah, relax here. We're just gonna get you a date here.
It's going kind of fast, and you know the hormones are just rising.
Yeah.
Hormones are rising,
keep,
Joseph.
Keep play the cards a little closer to the vest, right, there, Justine. All right. All right. So Joseph, what do you tell us? What you think about Justine?
I think she's a really great girl. I want to meet her. It's just she never talks to me.
She never talks to you?
Yeah.
Well, she says she talks to you all the time as Angel.
I know. Well, yeah, she's called me on the phone. She never tells me, that she never, like, lets me see her or anything.
Mm-hmm. Do you guys go to the same school?
No, we don't.
Well, next year we're going to the same school. We're going to the same high school.
Well, she was afraid that if she saw you in person, you would... She didn't know you knew her to be the same person.
I'm kind of like chunky.
Oh.
No, she knew you knew who Justine was, but she was afraid that if you found out she was also Angel, that would be the end of that.
Yeah, because I was kind of two different people. Like, Angel is me, and then for some reason, Justine, I just like.
All right, but.
Justine's not her real name. Angel's her real name.
No, Justine's not her real name. It's confusing. I know. I'm even confused.
Okay, quiet down. Yeah. Joseph.
Yes.
If you knew Angel and Justine were the same person, and you liked Justine and or Angel, why didn't you ask her out?
I don't know.
Don't care.
Well, that doesn't sound like you're that interested.
Yeah. I mean, yeah.
Yeah, what is the answer to that, Joseph?
Or you can just ask her out right now and get out of this.
Well, I don't want to go out with him if he doesn't like me.
What?
Well, I don't
Is there some special language or code they're speaking here?
I don't, like, if he doesn't like me, if he's interested in, like, someone else, or, like, it's not going to work out, then, I wouldn't want to go out with him.
Joseph, you seeing anybody now?
No.
You're not?
Oh, yes, I am. Sorry.
He's so quiet.
Are you seeing Angel?
No.
Justine?
No.
So you have a girlfriend, then?
Yes, I do.
All right. All right, so it's not going to work with Justine.
Right.
Okay. Hold on. Say, how do I put him on hold, Drew?
Yeah, he'll go on hold right now.
All right. Hey, Justine.
Yeah.
Bad news.
Yeah.
Well, I'm confused.
Don't worry.
Because first he went, great. I really wish she never likes me. See her.
He was just taken by surprise.
And then it's like, do you have a girlfriend? No. Well, oh, yeah.
Well, he just realized she may be listening.
He gets his share around the block, you know.
Well, you don't want to be around that, do you?
No, I don't. But I don't know what he says that's true and isn't true. Like, all the stuff he says that makes you totally fall for him, you know, so.
Like what?
Like I have a girlfriend?
No, just things that make you like a person.
All right, well, listen, I'll tell you what we're going to do.
Yeah.
We're gonna get to the bottom of Joseph in about 20 seconds.
Okay.
And then whatever answer he gives, that's like a judge.
It's binding.
That's final.
All right.
You must adhere to whatever his answer is. Joseph? What'd I do here, Drew?
Joseph?
He's on
the
line.
Hear him talking in the background.
Yeah.
Wait.
No.
Joseph.
Hold on, listen.
No.
Okay, Drew, where's this show going? Really? All right, putting Joseph on hold.
You can put her on hold, too.
All right, everyone's on hold. Justine.
Yes.
Okay, Joseph said he had a girlfriend.
Okay.
And he said he couldn't go out with you because he has a girlfriend.
Okay.
Okay, you can no longer pine for Joseph.
Okay.
You can't call him up as a mystery date or anything like that.
Yes, I know
he's back.
You're I don't care.
Well,
you're,
let's just get just one clarity. Come on, just one time. Get it real clear. I feel very unclear about that. Ooh, you're talking about Justine. Anyway.
Oh, who cares?
All right, Joseph.
Yeah.
All right, you have a girlfriend?
Yes, I do.
No, you don't.
Yes, I do.
You do. Well, what's her name?
Danielle.
Okay. And
well, why when we first called, were you so interested in meeting Justine?
Well, because I wasn't with her when I met Justine.
Yeah, but you said you were interested in meeting her. She never lets you meet her.
The guy's 14. He's got soap in his ears. Joseph.
Yeah.
You're not interested in Justine, are you?
Right.
All right.
Not as a girlfriend.
I don't know.
Okay. Stupid Drew.
Crystal.
I just punched the whole keyboard with my hand because Drew had to keep going back to figure out what the 13-year-old needed to say in between conversations with his mom.
All right.
Okay. Listen. He ain't interested.
Mm.
All right? Yep. Sorry, Justine. That's it. That's fine. Plenty of guys who will be. You just move on. You'll be fine. Trevor.
What's up, fellas?
You're 20.
Hey, Adam.
What's up?
Big fan of yours.
Thanks.
Kind of admirer because, you know, you're a blue collar kind of guy.
Well, I don't know about blue collar.
You were.
Well,
I want you to keep going. I need 90 to 2003.
90 to 2003.
Now you're making over $2 million a year, I figure, if you're paying $750,000, $800,000 in tax.
Well, let's get there. Mm-hmm. Let's see what happens here.
Mm. All right. So quick recap. I got my Social Security breakdown. It said how much money I made every year since I entered the workforce in 1980.
We just finished up with a zero year, I think.
Yeah.
You're making about $27,000.
80, yeah, I'll just recap. From 1980 to 1989, averaging about $4,000, $5,000 a year. So what are we in, 89?
Mm-hmm.
Just finished with a zero in 88?
Yeah, right.
89? Everyone's sitting down? $22,543.
Ooh, quite a comeback.
Read it and weep. Yeah, you know what I was doing then? Earthquake rehab for the city.
Yeah.
Sitting pretty at about 19 and change an hour.
Nice.
Yeah.
With benefits?
Yeah. No.
No. Right.
No.
What were you driving at that point?
Now I'm driving
At that point.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's what I mean. At that point, I'm driving a very sporty Datsun, 78 Datsun regular cab, bench vinyl seat, no headrest, no air conditioning.
78.
Mini pickup truck.
And, 78. Those things were not street.
They weren't mini. They weren't mini pickups. They were micro pickups back then. I have to grease my ass and get a running start to get into the cab. Yeah. No. What did you say? Crew cab?
Yeah.
No. Regular cab.
Ah.
Crew cab wasn't even around really in like 78 or 79. But keep in mind the car's 10 years older than whatever the date is.
All right. Moving along.
Now we're moving on to 1990. $6,312.
Mm-hmm.
Finished up with the city, feeling pretty good about myself. Probably did a little under the work. Still renting rooms and houses, doing this kind of stuff. Still, no dental, no medical insurance.
Under the table work at this point.
A little bit of that.
You're learning the system.
91. Now things starting to look up. Zero.
Oh, my God.
Zero in 91.
Uh-huh.
I'm not a child at this point, Drew.
No, I understand.
It's not like I'm 19 and I'm in college or anything. Mm-hmm. Then I'm, you know, starting to creep up on 27, 28 years old there at this point. Big fat zero. 92, $3,521. 93, ooh, pretty consistent. $3,984.
Maybe did you reach some threshold and start taking everything under the table? You figure, oh, I can get by with this.
I made a little under the table, but it wasn't really that much, really.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. 94. Yeah, now I'm living in La Cañada, I think.
Had a hot tub.
La Crescenta with Ralph and a couple other guys in a house up there.
I heard about that hot tub, too.
Yeah, good times. $6,442 for the year.
Mm-hmm.
But now, 95, I meet Jimmy Kimmel.
Oh, yeah.
Start doing a little radio, this and that. And the very, very generous Trip Reeb over here at K-Rock.
Are we back at zero?
It's back at zero. No. $36,221, ladies and gentlemen.
You have to upgrade your car by this point.
Now I'm driving a beat-up Supra. Because I don't need a truck because I'm starting to get into radio, but I'm still, I got the Supra about a year and a half before I completely got out of construction, so I'm still hanging wood and stuff out of the back of the car.
So we're now 8 years ago.
Yeah.
8 years.
All right, now we go to what, 96? $316,000, $424.
That is LoveLine on TV. that was more largely LoveLine on television.
Must have been TV LoveLine. 97, $354,661. Maybe, I don't know, starting doing the man show there?
No, not yet.
98, $543,453.
Almost a million there.
Almost. 99, $1,237,903. Yeah, but then it seemed to level out. And then in 2000, but I think I made more than this in 2000. I don't know, Drew, you're going to have to read this and see if this is the complete and total after a certain point. Then it's 1 million and change and 1 million and change after that. And then 202, it went up. But it's not shown there, the 202. Doesn't do it.
No, not yet recorded, it says.
Yeah.
That's the one that they're looking into right now, I suspect.
Yeah, there's marshals at my house right now.
Yeah.
All right, there you go. See, there's hope for everybody.
That's what I'm trying to say. I mean, I work in a warehouse. I load freaking trucks every day, making $12 an hour, which I think is pretty good at what I do.
Yeah.
And
just think where Adam was at 20, age 20.
Exactly.
Well, age 20, that would have been 80. Let's say 84, 85, 85.
Zero.
Oh, okay. Well, there you go.
Hey, Adam.
84, 9,367. That was a big year. That was for that decade, that about capped it.
That was biggest I had in the 80s was $9,000.
Well, no, you had one year of 17,000.
Ooh wee. Yeah. All right. That's why I told you the ladies loved me back then, Drew. You didn't believe me.
Yeah.
All right.
Adam.
Yeah, Trevor.
I heard you on a Stern Show about probably 6 months ago. Kathy Griffin busted you on the bus ride to the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
What happened with that, with your wife and all that?
Wife was pissed off.
Uh-oh. Yeah. You farting on the bus again with Jimmy or something?
No. Kathy, it's just a whole story about us being, we're going to the Super Bowl. We had a party bus. We stopped off somewhere in like Laguna. Some chick and her husband wanted to get on board the bus and go to San Diego. I said, yeah, fine. She asked. Then they got off the bus. Kathy made this big deal, like I was inviting chicks on the bus. My wife was listening. She got pissed off.
Oh.
You know. But I don't do what you do, Drew.
Which is what?
But stick my own nose up my own anus and start crying until I flood myself. That's what you do, Drew. Not me. I told her, hey, baby, get over it. Don't make me get the Social Security income list out and read that to you again.
I'm seeing your wife slowly start to wake up.
Yeah, don't worry about
it. She's had about an assful of your stuff.
Okay, but listen, Trevor's right. And look, if you do something wrong, you have to apologize.
Hmm.
If you apologize for something you didn't do, it implies guilt.
Yeah.
All right. I told her, get over it. All right. I didn't do anything.
Trevor didn't ask the question.
Then I yelled at Kathy. Okay. Trevor?
Yeah.
What was that question?
Oh, it's kind of funny, but my problem is when I'm in trying to when I do have sex, I have a it feels like kind of like when your hand falls asleep, that's my door.
Or is his penis disconnects from his body? It's not his penis.
Huh?
Maybe that's where yours goes, Adam, when you get that experience. You know, you've said you've had that time when your penis doesn't belong to you.
Yeah, that happened in one of those 0 years, I think.
Well, I think where Trevor is right now.
Oh, he's
in his life.
Making $12 an hour.
$12 an hour, that equals about $500.
You don't get your penis back until...
And, you know, that goes a long way in Arizona, too.
I hear that. You know, L.A., New York's a lot. No, it really doesn't.
Yeah, but seriously, when you're making the kind of money I was just reading off here and living in Los Angeles, you're ass out of luck.
Yeah.
All right. I mean, what's your rent?
About $400 a month. I live with a dude, though.
You have a one bedroom or
two bedroom?
Yeah. See, I was paying four something a month in a one bedroom with a dude.
What year? 80? 85?
But that's the
all,
point.
All through, it's all more through now. That, all through that period.
But you're living on the coast, though.
No.
No. What is your point? Yeah, that was in the early 80s that it was 400
and
change.
It's more now, and that was in the valley and the heat.
We had to have three guys living in a one bedroom. Yeah, so it's cheaper. It's better where you are. That's probably making $12 where you are is probably like making 18, 19 bucks out here. Wouldn't you say, Drew?
But at this point, I mean, Adam, would you ever imagine that you would clear $1 million in a year?
No.
I mean,
that's enough. I'm tired of my own success. All right, I don't know.
Yeah,
in fact, those
sort of numbers must have been like unimaginable.
What?
You know what I mean, when you were Trevor's age, doing what you were doing with $3,000 a year, thinking. Million? I mean, who? Is there such a person?
No, those are just weird, crazy numbers you heard about on Entertainment Tonight.
Right.
Yeah, as it turns out, it's not squat for a celebrity. We're angry, don't worry. I can't live off this.
We're angry?
We, meaning the royal we.
That's what I figured.
No, you're angry too, Drew. You're outraged.
Crystal?
Yeah.
You're 19?
Yeah.
What's up?
I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
I have couple intimacy issues. I wrote down a couple things that I want to state. First, sometimes I think that sex was wrong, like even when I'm like trying to do it, and I feel that I'm sometimes more intimate where I'm a little bit more liberal when I'm with people that I just like random hookups or something.
Right. That's right. A common syndrome that these sort of people sometimes feel that the sexual parts of themselves are sort of disavowed or wicked, and the only way they can experience them if they're with people that they don't feel guilt around.
Right. So I feel like if I'm dating a guy and I'm really liking him or something, if I get intimate with him, like, you know, I just feel like I'm being, like, dirty.
Yeah,
or if I'm
right. Yeah,
not
so, Crystal. Get over that.
Yeah. And also another thing is that I feel like, because I'm a virgin, but I feel like I have to, like, kind of hold that unless, like, no guy's going to like me or something. Like, I feel like there's certain steps.
Slow down. Where's all this energy coming from?
I'm just nervous, that's all.
I know, but you're 19, yeah. You're virgin. What? Where's all these crazy thoughts? Are you religious?
Yeah, I was growing up really, like, really religious.
Okay.
And so I feel like there have to be certain steps. Like,
did you have an eating disorder or something one time?
Do I have it? No.
Okay.
And what religion?
Christian.
Okay. And are you less religious now than you grew up?
Yeah, I'm less religious now.
You feel bad about that?
Not really.
Okay. Did were your parents abusive in some way?
yeah.
Yeah, that's what I get. Just wholesale abuse. Bad parts of yourself, and I'm going to keep away from
that. What kind of abuse?
Oh, every type of abuse.
Physical, sexual, mental?
Physical, mental, sexual.
Ooh, sexual abuse too? I thought you were a virgin.
Why do you get into that?
But,
you always do that.
Yeah.
If your dad Fs you, you're still a virgin. When dad Fs you when you're four, you're not a virgin. No. True. I would always get into this with Drew.
I think
it's weird.
You may be chaste, but listen, you know our callers consider virginity a technicality when a penis crosses the plane of the vagina. Period.
No, Drew, it's what you consider a virgin.
No, I think
you
consider
never
chaste
consider
virginity.
That a virgin. I just think it's a weird distinction to make.
I just feel like if I have sex with somebody, like, they're going to have that hanging over my head for the rest of my life or something.
Well, who sexually molested you?
My dad.
Ooh. Your dad?
Yeah.
The super religious guy?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Right. Well, look, I was just watching the whole thing last night on the Green River Killer, who was killing all those prostitutes up in the Seattle area. And, you know, he killed, like, 50 chicks, and you know, he was proselytizing during the day with his Bible to everybody, and you know, going to church and feeling all freaked out. Listen, sort of hyper religious is a mental disorder. It's a mental disorder. It's a confusing mental disorder. It's better when the person just does that thing all day long with the Napoleon hat on. But your dad was just as sick as that guy.
More sick. The other guy's quaint.
Yeah, Napoleon didn't F his kids. As far as I know.
Not the crazy Napoleon types.
Right. Even the real Napoleon, as far as I know. Oh, come on.
He's a goofy guy.
How dare you. Anyway, Crystal.
Yeah.
You got to get some therapy.
But the things that I've tried and...
No. I'm not even going to... That's not open for negotiation.
Yeah, you need to get
someone
in with
has been through what you've been through. Are you out of the house?
No.
Oh, my God.
My parents are divorced. I live with my mom. Mm.
All right. But your mom is the one who's just crazy enough to live with this guy.
Yeah.
Marry this guy.
She's not all that. She's not all there.
Yeah. We know that.
Yeah. She's pretty.
Okay. You need to get a job,
fight to keep it,
move out, get independent, and get some therapy and start getting your life in order.
It's like you always ought to be in some therapy, really. With that
And you have to, you're an adult now, unfortunately.
What can I do about this now?
The great news is, I have a boyfriend, and he wants
to get that kind of close, but I can't explain it to him unless he'll think I'm like psychotic or something.
All right. The good news is that you're able to have a relationship with quality people. You don't just go after and become attracted to a-holes, which is what often happens with this kind of history. So you're capable. It's just you're not totally available to those relationships when you get involved with one of those guys.
Yeah. True.
If you can't, what?
Let me, I mean, could you screw up your kid? If you sat down to put a battle plan together to F up your kid, to, you know, it'd be sort of zealot religious and then sexual abuse.
Yeah. It'd be C. Crystal's life.
Could there be anything worse? I mean, in terms of scrambling your kid.
Yeah, a little physical abuse in there.
All right, but let's say you can only pick two.
Yeah, you got, that's a good combo.
Thank you. Let's call it the ace combo.
Yeah, the ace, yeah.
Right. Okay, so she is doing relatively well considering where she's from.
She's able to have these relationships with quality people. That's a good thing. The fact that she can't be totally abandoning, you know, sexually and all that stuff.
Fine.
Yeah, that's all right.
But
we'll
listen,
take that.
I don't like people living in the same house they were sexually abused in when they're 19.
And we don't know that she's in the same house. She was with mom. They moved away from the dad.
Well, they got divorced, so dad could have been out of there. Crystal.
Yeah.
You in the same house?
No, but I do keep in contact with my dad. I do. Like, I've actually, because I just feel like he's my father. Like, I actually sat down with him a year ago, and I asked him why.
What'd he say?
And believe it or not, he just looked at me. He says, I thought that you wouldn't remember.
Well, then what?
I'm not kidding. It's
that's
not
a good
joke.
One.
It was pretty bad.
That's fine. Well, you did remember. Now what? What did he say then?
And he was just like, I'm really sorry. And I'm sorry, that's it. Because I love my dad. Like I keep in contact with him.
No, that's great love.
But I'm not trying to be all the way around him. I'm sometimes,
you know, part of the healing of this is being able to forgive people
exactly,
like this. Yeah.
Exactly. I'm not gonna be resentful and blame my parents for
well,
my problems.
But you've sacrificed. It's all a lot of things you say are really healthy, Crystal, but you've still sacrificed a piece of yourself. There's a piece of yourself that you keep sort of walled off and disavowed and you won't have anything to do with. And certainly won't let anybody else have a piece of it. It's not somebody you care about or respect. You got to let that part into your relationships. If you can't, then that is therapy, therapy, therapy.
All right. Well, that was a good, honest answer by
Dan. Yeah.
I know you'd remember. But it's like saying, why'd you commit the crime? I didn't think I was going to get caught. That's all that is. Still, one wildly effed up guy.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. So listen, again, people that are hyper-religious, let's just start treating them as folks that have a mental condition. Thank you.
Loveline, back in a minute. Loveline is brought to you by Trojan, America's number one condom, the most trusted for over 80 years.
Part of the madness all this week on CBS when Coca-Cola presents the Late Late Show with Craig Kilborn in New Orleans.
Spicy.
Hot guests, hot comedy, hot food.
By the way, what the heck is in jambalaya?
Coca-Cola presents the Late Late Show in New Orleans all this week on CBS.
Girls, please don't go wild.
Then catch the Final Four and the NCAA Division I Men's Basketball Championship live starting Saturday on CBS.
Ted.
Barbara.
Something's missing.
Missing?
In the bedroom?
In the where?
Trojan Man.
Trojan Man.
What are you doing here?
I'm here for her pleasure.
Her what?
Trojan Her Pleasure condoms. They're new, uniquely engineered to satisfy a woman's anatomical sensitivity while helping to protect.
Wow, you like this idea?
I love it.
Okay, I'm there.
New from America's most trusted condom, Trojan Her Pleasure. The pleasure she wants, the protection they trust. My job is done here.
Every day, 10 children are killed by gunfire.
Where have all the children gone? Long time passing.
Where have all the children gone? Long time ago.
Where have all the children gone? Gone to graveyards one by one.
Killing won't stop unless you help stop it. Call 1-800-WE-PREVENT to find out what you can do. Not one more lost life. Not one more grieving family. Not one more.
Oh, when will we ever learn?
A public service message from the U.S. Department of Justice, the Crime Prevention Coalition, and the Ad Council.
What's a frequency, Kenneth?
Hi, this is Mike Mills
and Peter Buck of REM.
For RAD, Rockers Against Drunk Driving. You know, it's okay to rock and roll and party. Just let someone else do the driving. Please don't drink and drive, and don't drive with someone else who's been drinking. Thank you. What's the frequency? Can I this year?
Hey, what are you doing after the game?
Well, there's a big party at Jason's. His parents are out of town, and there's going to be plenty to drink.
I think I'll pass.
You're going to pass up a party?
Well, it sounds more like trouble than a party.
Make the right choice. Underage drinking always means trouble. It's dumb, dangerous, and illegal.
You're going to miss all the fun.
I'm going to stay out of trouble.
A public service message from the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
If you're between the ages of 12 and 18, you're invited to play our Name That Theme Song Challenge. Just listen to the following songs and try to identify the popular TV shows they come from. Number one. Number two.
Come and knock on our door.
Come and knock on our door.
We've been waiting for you.
We've been waiting for you.
Three.
Please come back.
It's the bigger love.
Four.
Give it up.
And five.
Sweet Valley, Sweet Valley.
Now, if you can name two, you know your TV. If you can name three, you're a certified TV master. If you can name four or more, you probably need to get off the couch and get outside.
Run, walk, jump, pedal, paddle, blade, board, kick, dribble, spike. Get up, get out.
A public service message brought to you by the President's Council on Physical Fitness and Sports and the Ad Council.
Hey, our buddy Loveline, I'm Adam, that's Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Anderson gave me the point with his elbow, but the way you were giving it to me with your elbow, I thought you were going to unfold the finger.
Had an inch, sorry.
See what I'm saying? I was ready for the pow, the tomahawk.
Like
uno,
where you just can
yeah, but it was just the elbow this time, so I was waiting for the arm. All right, let's get to the phones and speak to Ben, who's 19. Ben, yeah. What's up?
Oh, not much. Just calling to, say both, first of all, that you are wonderful people. You're doing a great service for humanity here.
God bless you, Ben.
Oh, well, thank you, if I believed in him. But anyway.
Good man.
Somehow sounded depressing coming from Ben. But what's up?
No, he's just a smart guy, Ben is.
Oh, I was just... See, the problem is, I've been with my girlfriend for about 9 months, and our sex life is great, except for the fact that she really likes giving head, and I cannot get off with it.
Born gay.
Well, what about
life is to live gay?
Can you enjoy it when she does it?
Oh, it feels wonderful.
Okay, do you have to get off?
No, but she feels... Yeah, disappointed when I don't.
Well, she feels like she's not doing a good job.
Is she able to bring you to climax any other way?
Oh, most certainly.
Most certainly.
Quite.
Through manually and...
manually.
How so?
Wow, so manually, no problem. She gives you the hand, no problem.
Yeah,
and
it's
through
really
sex.
Strange, actually.
Yeah, that's different because the hand is usually just sort of a what you get when you don't get the BJ or when you didn't pay enough. But,
yeah, it's always been my experience.
Yeah, but not through the mouth. Well, listen, that's just your thing. Okay. And we came up with a little theory about guys like you, which is you're too passionate.
Hmm. Okay, I can see that.
You gotta put it somewhere. You know what I mean? Like, if you're getting a BJ, you need to have intercourse.
Hmm.
And you've got it in your head that this is how I'm going to have my orgasm.
Oh, so I'm just romanticizing it, I think.
Well, no, I don't know if it's necessarily romanticizing.
It's just not
right
what you
word.
Want, yeah.
Here's what I'm saying. If you were in prison and you had nothing but a glory hole, and someone said once a week you stick your dork through this hole in this plywood and this chick gives you a hummer, you'd figure out a way to get off.
Yeah.
But if you're in your bedroom... And your girlfriend's naked, and you keep thinking, the whole time she's giving you a BJ, you're thinking, I got to get in.
Yeah.
I got to get in. Yeah. You're not going to have an orgasm.
Yeah.
And that's not the way, that's not your optimal orgasm.
Right.
True.
It's like you don't want to waste it on the
yeah.
mouth.
Is it, that's right. Yeah, you got the belly, you got the comforter, you got the forehead, you got the small of the back. All these places you could waste it. Why waste it in the mouth? But Drew, as a man of great passion, you sympathize, yes?
Sympathize, yes.
So, Ben, you're fine. You just have to explain to her that's not you.
Okay. I'd also like to challenge Adam about something that he said a long time ago, ceramics.
Yes.
I know ceramics, and I'd like you to test me, maybe, because all of the previous callers have been rather inept.
Drew, right. Please tell this guy he's gay.
All right. Yes. Everyone wants Drew to tell you you're gay.
I act. I do ceramics. I know I seem gay, but I'm quite straight.
Yeah, I don't get gay.
All right. How would one do a pinch pot?
One would do a pinch pot by first starting out with a moderately moist piece of clay, and then sticking the thumb in and rotating around, pinching upward.
All right. Gay enough. Fair enough. And
how so?
How about a coil pot?
A coil pot. You'd roll out a long snake
penis-like
of clay, and then you'd coil it around a circular base.
All right.
Ask a glazing question.
Now, when you're putting one coil on top of the next coil, how would you get them to stick?
You'd score them, and you might use a little bit of the slip from the bottom of your water.
Slip! Did you hear that, Drew?
Yeah.
That's a ceramic term.
Oh.
You know what slip is?
It's where your water is, I guess.
Oh, no. Slip is the really, really wet clay on the bottom of your water.
Yeah, it's like the swampy stuff. Yeah.
Disgusting.
All right, let's see. Okay, Einstein, you're batting 1,000 so far. How about a slab pot?
What you do is you take you measure out a circle, and then you get an appropriate size just slab of clay that you flattened out. You cut it, and you... Mm-hmm. Take it and you roll it into the cylinder, score both.
Mm-hmm.
You're gay.
All right. And a
glazing question.
Okay, well,
this was ceramic. This is ceramic. That was just
firing question.
Okay.
Raikou? Yes, the process, Raikou, and firing a pot.
You got me there, actually. There
Ooh.
You go.
Okay.
You got me there.
Aha! Yes, Raikou. Is how like the Indians would fire a pot. They would just make a fire and get the coals, the embers going, and then just set it down in the earth. It's sort of like cooking a pig in the ground.
Okay, so I've seen that in India, actually, where they take the mud ware and they bury it in the ground and with hot coals. Yeah, okay.
They call that the Raikou method there.
Oh, okay. I did not know that.
All right. And Raikouter, good singer-songwriter.
There you go.
All right, Ben. Hey, good times, everybody.
Whoo!
See, my ceramic brethren. By the way, who said my ceramic major in high school would not pay great, great dividends one day?
Nothing you learn is useless.
Slab pots, coil pots. Come on. You think chicks can resist that kind of talk? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I'm wet.
1985. I got a nice big goose egg up for the earnings number, and I'm talking about Raikou. Couple of chicks? Yeah. Jay?
Gentlemen.
You're 30. What's up?
Greetings. Love the show.
Thanks, Jay. Love you.
Oh, yeah. Hey, I got a theory. I'm getting, I'll be honest with you there, Adam. I enjoy your show. You're a funny guy, but I'm getting damn tired of listening to you always talking about wanting to kill people all the time for various reasons, most of which are really good. Mm-hmm. I guess my problem is that, you're missing the boat. I know that eventually you're going to rule the planet.
I'm looking forward to that day, yes.
Yeah. I think you've got a community here that could help you out, and I want to offer our services because I, too, have a theory. You're always talking about, like a week ago, you said something about shooting people when they apply for their welfare and stuff. You just show up at the house with your silenced pistol, and when you ask them to sign the papers, you just drill them.
Yeah, I don't think that was just applying for welfare, though.
But it had something to do with state assistance. You know, you require an interview or something, and then when you show up at the house, instead of giving him the state assistance, you just give him a lead sandwich.
Yeah.
This was the disability thing. This is maybe back injuries.
Yeah.
We're getting into that area.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. It was not quite. A simple maiming would suffice for some of these other things. But anyway, go ahead, Jay.
Well, my theory is that a lot of the people who, you know, apply for the disability or apply for state assistance erroneously or who are scamming the system are also customers of ours. And so I think in order to help facilitate...
You're in law enforcement?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Why not just open up a hunting season 24 hours a year? For us. I mean, we're fully equipped.
For the cops?
Sure, why not? You know, like one felony conviction or three misdemeanors and you're...
Shut up! Yeah, I got no problem with that, Jay.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
All those people are on assistance.
Yeah, you do what you got to do.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. The law of the streets. Law of the streets.
Take a finger, you know. Guy who gets the most kills or whatever gets a trophy.
Yeah. What, were you, you work in the street or are you behind a desk? Where are you?
No, I'm on the street.
You're on the street.
Right.
That's my man.
I walk among you.
All right, Jay.
But I don't write jaywalking tickets.
Yeah. Yeah, you don't do any of that chicken-ass stuff.
That's right.
You do the real law enforcement, and you look the other way on consensual crimes like prostitution and a guy dealing a dime bag, right, Jay?
Not really.
Oh, all right.
Sadly, no.
All right, well, listen, don't shoot anybody.
No, not tonight.
No, but I'll give you a list one day when I'm in charge.
Who to shoot?
Yeah. You need to go after him.
Jay certainly seems like he's anxious to comply.
Yeah. Well, you know my theory about cops.
It's ringing in my head currently.
They could have easily gone the other way. And some of them actually did while wearing the shield. All right. Crystal?
Hello?
You're 18?
Yeah, hi. Adam, I love you.
Love you, baby, but we got to take a quick break, all right?
Fine.
All right, so, Drew, what's Crystal's problem?
She's dating a 38-year-old she met online.
All right.
Bad times.
We'll get into that after this.
LoveLine, back in a minute.
Hey, this is Dan from Tonic. For RAD, Recording Artists Against Drunk Driving, reminding you that drunk drivers are still the number one killer of young adults in this country. Please use your head and save your life and those on the road. Always choose a designated driver. Remember, music lives. You should too.
You can never go home again. You can never go home again.
Hey, what's up? This is Darius from Hootie and the Blowfish for RAD, Recording Artists Against Drunk Driving. When you go out and party and you get drunk, then drive, you're not only loaded, you're a loaded weapon. When you celebrate, designate. Choose a designated driver every night. Remember, music lives, and so should you.
Bob Sheehan from Blues Traveler for RAD, Recording Artists Against Drunk Driving. I like to party just as much as the next guy, maybe even more. But the one thing I won't do after I've had a few is get in the car and drive. Don't blow it. Always choose a designated driver. Remember, music lives and so should you.
I wish that I knew what I know now. When I was younger.
Hello, this is Rod Stewart for RAD, Recording Artists Against Drunk Driving. When you go out and party, get drunk, then drive, you're not only loaded, you're a loaded weapon. When you celebrate, designate. Choose a designated driver. Remember, music lives, and so should you.
I wish that I knew what I know now.
Hi, I'm Serenity, and these are my friends, Missy and Stephanie.
You know, a lot of things happen to us every day that we have no control over.
But HIV and other sexually transmitted diseases aren't things that just happen to you. You do have a choice.
You can choose to use a condom, have safe sex, and take control of your life.
Asking for a condom isn't stupid. It's smart. It shows that you care about yourself and your partner.
You can do something about sexually transmitted diseases.
Use a condom.
Every partner.
Every time.
We do.
A message brought to you by Wicked Pictures and AIDS Project Los Angeles.
I don't know.
Hey, what's up? This is Darius from Hooting the Blowfish for Rad, recording artist against drunk driving. When you go out and party and you get drunk, then drive, you're not only loaded, you're a loaded weapon. When you celebrate, designate. Choose a designated driver every night. Remember, music lives, and so should you.
Hi, this is Joe Elliott from Def Leppard for Rad, recording artists against drunk driving. Planning on going out and having a party? Great, have a lot of fun. But do me a big favor and don't blow it. Always choose a designated driver. Remember, music lives. You should too.
Do you know whether it's a girl or a boy?
You're pregnant and you're looking forward to that baby. You'd like to have a drink just to relax, but you don't want to do anything that might hurt your baby. Any other time, it would be just an innocent drink. But while you're pregnant, the best choice for you and your baby is to stop drinking and call your doctor for advice. While you're pregnant, don't drink. Don't risk your baby's future. A public service message from the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Hey yo, LoveLine, man, I'm the Zabala.
Who is your guest tomorrow night, man?
Now, Tim's coming up. Who?
Randy Jackson. From?
He's that country singer.
No, I think it's the guy from American Idol.
American Idol. Randy Jackson from American Idol's coming in here tomorrow night. All right. We'll talk to him tomorrow night. And, Crystal?
Yeah, hi.
All right.
Okay, Adam, I love you, and Drew, I just want to tell you inspire me.
Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Okay. A friend of mine and I, about 2 weeks ago or 3 weeks ago.
Oh, smoke alarm.
Yep.
Decided that.
Crystal, hold on a second.
All right.
Last time I called in, you guys did this too.
That we heard, that we listened to your smoke alarms?
Uh-huh.
And gave you endless crap about it?
Yeah.
And you didn't change the batteries?
It's not my house.
How long ago was this?
Maybe 2 or 3 weeks ago.
Do you live there?
No, I don't. I'm a nanny.
Ah.
So anyways.
Place has nannies, so they can't change their smoke alarm?
Hold on, it's getting ready to go off again soon. Let's just all be quiet. They usually go every 33, 38.
I think they go minute 30.
No.
Hmm?
Okay. All right, let's just listen.
Okay.
Go ahead, Crystal. Talk quietly so we can hear the smoke alarm.
There it was.
There it goes.
Are you ready?
Yeah. It's
okay.
About 50 seconds.
A friend and I, as a joke, we decided to do this online dating thing and just kind of joke to see how many responses we'd get from our ads. And this guy actually responded, and I didn't expect anything of it, but I started talking back and forth with him, and we ended up meeting, and at first I didn't really find him that attractive, but the more I got to know about him, I guess I kind of did, and I just feel a little dysfunctional about it, although I am really into him, and...
He's 20 years, more than twice your age.
Uh-huh.
I understand how you could have a relationship.
Are you having sex?
Mm-hmm.
Oof. Hold on 1 second, okay?
Yeah. It's coming.
There it is.
Okay. Go on.
I just feel like I feel dysfunctional because I just think that, yeah, there's an age difference, but I am into him, and I just get this horrible feeling from him that... Because he says things like, well, we're just friends right now, and we'll see what happens.
No, but he's having sex with
you,
right?
He's found an 18-year-old who's willing to let him have sex with you, him.
Right.
And that's it, period. That's the end of the story. I mean, met her on the web. I mean, man, this guy
guy's a jackass.
Yeah.
What's he do?
He owns his own company.
Doing what?
Weddings.
Oh. He's gay, too.
That's what I thought at first, but... Mm-hmm. Actually, he kind of reassured me that he's not, I hope.
He could be married for all you know.
He's not. I've been to his house. I've seen some of his assets.
Hold on.
There it is. Okay.
All right.
Yeah, listen, you're nannying for these people. Don't you think in behalf of those children you got to climb up there and change the batteries?
You know what? That's a really good idea. It does bug me. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Evidently not that much because you called 2 weeks ago and it was going off.
A couple months ago and it was going off.
And what she about said, the jacket? You said two weeks, didn't you?
Yes, she did.
But I didn't call you 2 weeks ago. It's just been like 2 weeks, 3 weeks since I've been seeing him.
No, you told us we were hassling you 2 weeks ago about the smoke alarms.
I didn't say 2 weeks ago. I think you guys got confused. I didn't mean 2 weeks ago. A couple months ago. Okay.
All right. That makes it worse. And what about the idiots who own that house?
They can afford nannies. They're worried about the kids.
You know what? I can't answer that for you. I just.
Where is that smoke detector?
It's in the kitchen.
In the kitchen.
Mm-hmm.
And where are you?
In the living room.
In the living room. You can hear it.
There it goes.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God.
I'll listen.
No, you tell the owner. Is there a male around there?
No, it's a single parent.
Ooh. It's a chick?
Yeah.
Now, this is what happens when women try to run things.
She's very interesting.
Yeah.
What'd she do?
Bartender.
Ooh.
All right, so she's an idiot. This is a place. It's an idiot. I mean, look, that's a reptile. She's got an iguana brain.
Should I get out of this?
Yes, get out.
I'm thinking maybe it'll, like, lead to something, but I know
like
that...
Like what, a wedding? Like you're going to marry this guy?
Hold on a second.
No, too early.
No, right now.
I like him. I think if he probably asked me, like, next week, I might say yes. He seems really secure in his life. That is very attractive to me. He seems very intelligent.
Hold on.
Okay, thank
you. Sure, you ever get tired of being wrong?
Honestly, I just kind of crave the, he's very stable, it seems like.
Yeah, okay. Well, he's an idiot, though. He's 38. When you're 25 and look at the guys dating 18-year-olds, you'll flip out.
There's nothing wrong with you, Crystal.
Okay.
Just find a decent 23-year-old guy.
No way this guy's getting married. A guy that's surfing the internet for 18-year-olds, no way he's getting married.
And look.
And if he is, you'll be hating life if you marry this guy.
Listen. Listen, ladies. The guys give this rap. You know, hey, just having a good time. Hey, just hey, look, think of you as a great friend.
We'll see what happens.
Think of you as a great friend. Yeah. Think of you as a great friend. And then.
Put her back up so we hear the smoke alarm go off.
No.
No.
That's eight times. Not enough? Jesus Christ.
Never gets old.
What kind of colossal tard lives in a house where you can hear the goddamn smoke detector chirping every 51 seconds?
Three rooms away.
For months. Oh, my God. Oh. You can't, there's you just can't convince me. Here's the deal. Here are the two choices with that person.
Deaf?
Okay, three choices. Deaf, just flat out, just really have a reptile brain.
Retarded, yeah.
Reptilian retard brain. Or super genius. 300 IQ. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, so exquisitely focused on stuff, you know, like Einstein. Hair's a mess, wearing the same suit every day.
Yeah.
So deep in
thought.
Wears
his shoes on the wrong feet and doesn't notice.
So deep in thought.
Yeah.
Huh? Well, which one do you think it is?
Deaf.
Huh?
Retard, yeah.
Thank you. Christine?
Hi.
You're 19. What's up?
A few weeks ago, my boyfriend started getting a cold sore.
Yeah.
And he wouldn't go down on me because he was afraid that it would... caused me to get like herpes.
He is a smart man. That's how herpes is passed along.
It is?
Yep.
Okay. I just was checking because I didn't know if it was the same thing.
You can always use a dental dam. Although even then, you shouldn't do it. Because even taking the latex barrier and laying it down there, you could, you know, it's not 100%.
I got out of oral sex the same way.
You learned how to do the...
No,
you went to a Hollywood makeup class to concoct.
No, I just used soldering iron.
Oh, just burn yourself.
Just right on the upper lip.
It'll start scarring eventually.
Well, you move it around.
Just go to makeup class. You get a nice big cold sore you can paint on.
That can peel off, and sometimes you don't know you're wiping your nose and it's on your hand, and then you're in front of the old lady. You take a soldering iron, just quick, just like when Kung Fu branded the inside of his wrist, you know, just pow.
Yeah.
Brian, explain that one to Lauren, by the way, the Kung Fu reference text. And just
she's watching TV.
Just pow right there.
All right, Christine.
Perfect.
All right. Good tips. And one more call, Drew. Who's been on hold the longest?
That one.
Okay.
This one.
Michael?
Yeah.
You're 18?
Yeah, hi.
How do you approach your real dad?
Yeah.
You never met him?
No.
Were you up for adoption or something?
No, the funny thing is that my mom actually told me about this when I was 15.
Mm-hmm.
And
do you have somebody you call dad?
Yeah.
Leave it alone.
Who is that?
I don't know, because like right now I'm just like to the point where I don't know where I am in life. And
well,
it's not his fault.
Do you have a stepdad?
Yeah.
And do you get along with him?
Not at all.
Ooh.
Not at all. All right. Well, it's payback time. We gotta find real dad.
Yeah.
And
well, the fantasy is real dad's gonna be this wonderful
and
guy.
And why is real dad?
Not necessarily. Just I think to ease my curiosity about it.
Yeah. Well, I there's something there. Does he live in the town you live in?
No, he lives in Florida.
Have you? Oh, Florida.
Bad sign. Yeah.
Shocking. He's in Florida. And have you spoken to him?
No, I am like two steps away from getting his phone number, but I don't know what the right way to.
Can you confide in your mom about this?
Yeah.
I would do that.
Send him a letter and email something first, see if he responds.
And just because you're not getting along great with step-pop doesn't mean you need to go search real deadbeat, doesn't love you, alcoholic, Floridian, working at a Waffle House pop.
Yeah.
Talk to mom. See what she says. Yeah. We'll be back.
Okay, so I know there's nothing wrong with me. So what's up?
So I was like you, and I used to think that these datelines were totally cheesy.
Why can't I meet anybody?
But I tried everything else and thought, what the hell? So I called the dateline and actually met a cool guy.
I called the dateline and I hooked up with some cool people.
Believe it or not, other normal people are out there looking too.
877-889-DATE.
1-800-LOVE-191. We'll be right back.
Okay, people, come on, settle down. Everyone settle down. Joanne DiCarlo.
Present.
William Robertson.
Here.
Raymond Vega.
Yeah, I'm here.
Peter Lawrence. John Earhart. Marona Maxwell. Andrea Thompson.
Every day, 10 children are killed by gunfire. 10 dead kids. 10 kids too many. The violence won't stop until you help stop it. To find out how, call 1-800-WE-PREVENT for free information. That's 1-800-WE-PREVENT. And please call today. Not one more lost life. Not one more grieving family. Not one more. A public service message from this station, the U.S. Department of Justice, the Crime Prevention Coalition, and the Ad Council.
Hello, my name is Rome, and I'm here for Rad. Music is very important to me, but what's most important is life. Please, please choose a designated driver. Don't drink and drive.
You put the spell on me. I'm hooked, baby. Crazy love.
What'll it be, lady?
You think you might be pregnant. You need to see your doctor. You want to tell your family, and you need to stop drinking alcoholic beverages. The best choice for you and your baby is to stop drinking and call your doctor for advice.
Congratulations. You were right. You're pregnant.
If you have questions about drinking during your pregnancy, ask your doctor. Be good to your baby right from the start. A public service message from the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Hey, this is Kate Pearson from the B-52s. For Rad, getting drunk is your own business, but when you drive drunk, you make it everybody's business. Don't drink and drive. Be responsible, plan ahead, and choose a designated driver. Remember, music lives, and so should you.
Hey, Larry, baby, you want to go for a ride?
Why, Vince, I didn't know you cared.
I don't, but I'm looking for a baby.
But, Vince, we're crash dummies.
Well, your head's about the size of a baby.
What are you doing?
Taking it off! I'm using your head in a rear-facing infancy.
Why?
To show how babies up front are in airbag danger.
You know I get sick when I ride backwards and without a body.
Up in front, kids won't know what hit them when the airbag blows.
Then why do people put their kids up front, Vince?
I don't know. Maybe it makes them feel better to see them sitting by their side. Although, if my baby looked like you, he'd ride in the trunk.
Hey, Where are we going, Vince?
Yeah, you know that brick wall with the big bullseye?
I can see it vaguely in the back of my mind.
Well, in 2 seconds, that's exactly where it's going to be. Holy cow, Larry, you're embedded in the seat.
Tire iron.
I can't understand you. I'll go get a tire iron.
Thank you.
You could learn a lot from a dummy. Buckle your kids in the back seat. A message from the Department of Transportation and the Ad Council.
Hi, this is Dennis Franz of NYPD Blue for RAD, recording artists, actors, and athletes against drunk driving. My character, Andy Sipwitz, has learned that there are a lot of things in life you have no control over. Fortunately, driving drunk isn't one of them. If you drink, don't drive. Choose a designated driver, and if one of your friends has been drinking, get the keys. Friends don't let friends drive drunk.
A message from the Department of Transportation, Ad Council, National Association of Broadcasters, and RAD.
Did you hear what Smokey said? Did you hear what Smokey said?
I want to know if you heard what Smokey said. Smokey said only you.
This is Marty Stewart from my pal Smokey Bear, reminding you if you must burn debris or trash, do it safely. Check local laws on burning and never burn on dry when you date. Remember, only you can prevent forest fires.
Smokey didn't mention nobody else. Smokey said only you.
This message from the USDA Forest Service and your state forester and advertising council.
Hey, this is Kate Pearson from the B-52s. I want to take a minute and talk about unsafe sex. It's not a good idea. If you're going to have sex, use a latex condom.
Hey, I'm Fred Schneider, and I want to talk about sex and condoms. If you're talking about sex, then you better be talking about using latex condoms.
If you're going to have sex, use a latex condom. You have enough to worry about in your life, and you don't need a sexually transmitted disease.
Help reduce the risk. Get some latex condoms and use them. Now that's cool.
Brought to you by Westwood One and Trojan, America's number one condom, trusted for over 80 years.
That song. All right. Should we take a little extended break here, Drew?
Yeah.
All right. Randy Jackson tomorrow night from American Idol, which I saw tonight. So I'm going to recognize him when he comes in. So until next time, this is Adam Carolla for Dr. Drew saying mahalo.
Hello, I'm Lucius. Hello, Mr. Osama Bin Laden.
This has been LoveLine. The opinions expressed on this show are not necessarily those of the staff, management, sponsors, or this station.
The producer for Loveline is Ann Wilkins Ingold. Loveline is a presentation of Westwood One Entertainment.